Good morning. Welcome to worship here on this, the day the Lord has given us. It is good to be here together, to come and gather in God's presence in this time and place for this time of worship. Warm welcome to those of you who are here with us in person, whether you're a longtime member or first-time guest. It's a delight to see you here. Welcome also to those who may be worshiping with us via the live stream this morning. Our worship this morning today is a little bit unusual in that ordinarily, quite often at least, the first Sunday after Thanksgiving begins the season of Advent. But by the sort of trick of the calendar this year, there's an extra Sunday in there. So this is not the first Sunday of Advent, but that makes it the last Sunday of the previous church calendar year, and the last Sunday is acknowledged as the Reign of Christ or Christ the King Sunday. So Christ as King, as kind of the final thing to celebrate and remember in the church calendar year, will be one theme in worship today. But we are going to do kind of a bit of a lead into Advent as well, and I'll say some more about that later, kind of a pre-Advent theme around the themes of, especially today, the fear of the Lord. In Advent, we'll talk more about be not afraid, but today it'll be a little bit more like be some afraid, the right kind of afraid, and we'll explore a bit what that means. But those themes of Christ as King and the fear of the Lord come together in a call to worship. Gene is going to lead us in this from Psalm 111. I invite you, if you would, to rise as able and join where indicated as God calls us together to worship through these words today.
Let's join together in this call to worship. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Praise the Lord. I will extol the Lord with all my heart in the council of the upright and the assembly. Great are the works of the Lord.
They are honored by all who delight in them.
Glorious and majestic are all his works. He has caused the wonders to be remembered.
The Lord is gracious and compassionate.
He provides food for those who fear him.
He remembers his covenant forever.
He has shown his people the power of his works.
Giving them the lands of other nations.
The works of his hands are faithful and just. They are established forever and ever.
Enacted in faithfulness and uprightness.
He provided redemption for his people. He ordained his covenant forever.
Holy and awesome is his name.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
All who follow his precepts have good understanding.
And dear friends, brothers and sisters, to the one to whom eternal praise belongs, that is the one who welcomes us into this time and place of worship. May the grace of our Lord and King, Jesus Christ, and the love of God the Father, and the abundant fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen and amen. Come, let's worship God together in song.
Oh God, be on the brain.
That God of glory calls us to constantly renew our walk, our relationship with Him. And we do that, one of the ways we do that is through a time of confession. We begin today with words from the psalmist in Psalm 139. It says, "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me, your right hand will hold me fast." And the psalmist adds this prayer, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." As we lead in then to this time of confession, we sing, "He will hold me fast."
Thank you.
Let's pray. Gracious Lord, we confess that we are often a fearful people. It is not easy for us to rest in you and to rest in you alone. It's not easy to feel secure in a world that is shifting beneath our feet. And so often we fear for our jobs, for our country, for our own health, for our families, and for all those we love. Fear is a language we speak fluently. Gracious Lord, we need faith in your wisdom and your providence and your goodness, so that no matter what it is we fear, you, in your wisdom, are guiding us and walking with us. Come and move among now your often fearful people and teach us to walk in your ways. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. And hear this word of assurance as God both assures us of pardon and calls us to live holy and renewed lives from Deuteronomy chapter 10. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God ask of you but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to observe the Lord's commands and decrees that I am giving you today for your own good. To the Lord your God belong the heavens, even the highest heavens, the earth and everything in it. Yet the Lord set his affection on your ancestors and loved them, and he chose you, their descendants, above all the nations as it is today. In Christ Jesus, these promises and calls are ours. Thanks be to God. We continue in song.
We were reminded in a recent adult ed the way in which we give is just as important as the offering itself. Since COVID, deacons have been bringing the plate up to the front as a COVID measure, first of all, so that we would not touch the plate, but also as a meaningful moment still in the service to recognize the gifts that we are giving God. And I know a lot of us are giving online these days. This is a practice probably because many of us don't carry cash anymore, or it's just easier. And in further discussions after the adult ed, we were talking about how can we give meaningfully online as well. And one of the ways we came up with is to, during the time that the deacons are coming forward and praying, that we pray for the gift that we gave online, whether that was a couple weeks ago, if we don't remember when we do auto give, but still have that meaningful time that we are thanking God for the gift he has given us and the way that we are giving back to whatever ministry we have dedicated online. So with that in mind, just want to remind everybody that you can give online. You can give in the plate that comes forward. We will take offerings also after the service in the back towards the doors there, or in the, what do you call that, the narthex. We have some plates there too, so we welcome it at any time. So this is just a gesture for our offering. But anyway, today's offering is for the Christian Education Fund. There's a few families here that we support their Christian education, and I know that they gladly welcome our support for the tuition, for the tuition that goes to the teachers and the staff and the everybody else at the Christian schools. We also give to the ministries here at Shawnee for the, I mean, there's so many things that we give. Anything in the budget is part of our ministry fund, and we ask that you remember that today. So let us pray. Precious Lord, the giver of all good things, we are thankful for your love and generosity. Remind us to share that love and generosity with others, whether that be giving to the wonderful staff and the tuition at the Christian schools, supporting the kids in our congregation that attend these schools, or to our ministry fund. We ask you bless these gifts. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, Sarah. We're going to continue in prayer in just a moment. I did want to mention one item that may or may not have come across your radio screen. I learned this week of the death of Reverend Ken Vandegrind. He was a pastor here from 1983 to 1989. He passed away from cancer this week. Even in recent years, he's been ministering at First CRC in Byron Center. The funeral, I've learned, will be tomorrow, Monday at 2 o'clock at Stroh in Byron Center. I think I have that information right. But just wanted you to be aware of that. Those of you who have some years of history there will want to remember them, and we want to give thanks for his life and pray for the family today. We're going to pray then together for the needs of the Church of the World, drawing especially on some of the Apostle Paul's comments and prayer in Colossians 1. Let's go to God together in prayer. O God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we gather in your presence in this time of worship and turn our hearts towards you now in prayer. We rejoice together in the good news of the gospel that has come to us and that has borne fruit in us, that has sparked joy and wonder, that has kindled in us deep trust in what you have done in the past and all that you've promised to do in your glorious future. We pray that you would help us to live lives that are worthy of you, and that we would seek to please you in every way, that our lives would bear good fruit. We are workers in your vineyard, the rich garden harvests of this world, and we pray that you would make us strong to take part in everything bright and beautiful that you have for us and that you intend for the world. You are the God who rescues people from dead ends and dark dungeons. You bring us up out of the pit into the light of Christ. When we look at Christ, we see your purpose for how things ought to be. Christ our King, the one in whom all things hold together, the one in whom all the dislocated pieces of the universe get fixed and fit together. And so we sing and we say, praise be to you, Lord and King Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we pray longing for the full coming of the kingdom of Jesus. We pray that his kingdom of justice and peace would come and take hold, especially in those places of violence and war. O God, who sets the captives free, we give thanks for the release this week of at least some of those who've been held hostage in Israel and Palestine. And we plead for the hard work of peace building to continue. O God, who defends the vulnerable, come to the defense of those who are caught in the chaos of war, who are so deeply in need of protection, who are in need of rescue. And Lord Jesus Christ, Prince of Peace, we ask you to make wars cease to the ends of the world and bring us signs, even now, of your coming kingdom. Raise up persons and communities of peace and empower them to bear witness to your ways of suffering love. O God, who brings comfort to those who mourn. We pray for those who are grieving the loss of loved ones, for those who feel it especially through these weeks of holiday gatherings and family celebrations. We pray additionally this week for the family and for the wife and children of Reverend Ken Vandergren. We give thanks for the years of service to Christ, including to this congregation. We pray that you would bless and care for that family and those who are grieving his passing. O God of healing, we pray again this day for Karina's health. We pray for relief from the cancerous scourge that has afflicted her body and threatens her life. Give her and Derek and their family all that they stand in need of each moment and this day. We give thanks for Carolyn Cooper's successful hip surgery this week and pray that you would speed her recovery. Lord, in whatever other burdens or pains are being carried by those present today, we ask that you hear their prayers and ours on their behalf and make us together faithful, not only in prayer for one another, but in acts of kindness and care and love. Father, we give thanks for the conference that the Christian Agape Church was able to hold here over the last couple days, that people might be trained in knowing your word and loving it and serving one another in Jesus' name. Empower them as a congregation and bless the ministry that they continue. Oh Lord, we pray for those in this world who regularly suffer as servants of Christ Jesus. We pray for those who endure ridicule or rejection or economic hardship because of their witness to Jesus. Encourage those who are imprisoned or tortured, and help those who live in perpetual fear of such suffering. Lord, even in their suffering, may they find that by your Spirit they're able to bear witness to Christ, his grace, and his truth. And grant that we, with them, would become fully mature in Jesus. Do this work in and through us now, even in this moment as we prepare to open the scriptures together. May not only the scriptures open to us, but our hearts open to you. May the words spoken and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing to you, and may they build us up in faith and hope and in love. All this we pray in the name of Christ Jesus. Amen. As we prepare to open God's word together, we're first going to sing a song of preparation. I invite you to rise as able as we sing All of Our Tomorrows.
See you.
As I mentioned earlier, we are planning through Advent to Christmas, to go through a series called Be Not Afraid. That series, just to acknowledge on the front end, was some of the ideas for it were published in the Reformed Worship magazine. It was a series put together by a friend and colleague at a church in Washington, D.C., in Washington, D.C. Christian Reformed Church. And one of the nice helps they gave in that was the idea for a pre-Advent Sunday, which works quite nice for us on this Christ the King Sunday leading into Advent. And the suggestion came to, before the series on Be Not Afraid, to focus on the fear of the Lord. And so we'll read today one of many passages we probably could have read on that topic from Proverbs chapter 1. So hear the word of the Lord. The Proverbs of Solomon, son of David, king of Israel. For gaining wisdom and instruction, for understanding words of insight, for receiving instruction in prudent behavior, doing what is right and just and fair. For giving prudence to those who are simple, knowledge and discretion to the young. Let the wise listen and add to their learning, and let the discerning get guidance. For understanding proverbs and parables, the sayings and riddles of the wise. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge, but fools despise wisdom and instruction. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So before we go to this, what will be this series on Be Not Afraid, we start with a Sunday and a day where we get to reflect on the theme to be afraid, be very afraid. Fear is, on the whole, one of these experiences and emotion that we would rather avoid. It's more on the negative end of the scale. And yet, I was thinking, people do sometimes seek it out. They want to be scared. I'm not necessarily one of those people. I mean, there are fun moments when someone jumps around the corner and startles you, and you start out a little angry, but you end up both laughing. I can see where that's kind of fun. Pranks. I've never been a big haunted house guy, but they do exist, and people go to them. Halloween usually has a little bit of the spooky and the fearfulness about it. But maybe it's especially like horror movies. Some people love a good horror movie. My experience in that realm is pretty limited, I have to warn you. But I saw that Christianity Today had recently started a podcast called Be Afraid, where they have someone who's exploring the sort of horror genre and what it is. What is it that draws people to it, and why do people keep coming back? It seems to be a genre that is growing to some degree in popularity. But I remembered one time, I was thinking, just a quick story of a time that I remembered the fear and the fun being kind of closely related. It wasn't a horror movie, but maybe it's a similar experience. I was in high school, probably the latter years of high school, and I had a good buddy who had a truck, and we went driving out, and there was kind of out in the country, out in the farm fields, there was this cemetery that had a reputation. And it had a reputation for having a glowing tombstone. Okay? So we thought, well, let's go see if we can see the glowing tombstone. Now, the rumor was there was a light on a farm across the street that when it was on would catch that tombstone just right. But whatever, we wanted to go see it. So we're out there at night, and it's dark, and we pull up. And at this particular cemetery, when you get out, right away there's these tall iron gates, big, black, spooky-looking iron gates. And then there's this long row of evergreens on either side, and we got out and walked this. And there's like these evergreen kind of tall shrub bushes on either side. And so now we're starting to have a little fun with it, right? Truck turns off, the lights go out, it gets dark, it's quiet, there's a little breeze. And we start kind of, you know, riling each other up into this, saying little things like, man, you can just imagine something or someone hopping out behind that tree right there, can't you? And so we walk down this, that's maybe, I'll say, 70, 80 yards of trees and bushes, and every, you know, with every tree we pass, you're kind of doing this and looking over your shoulder. And you can feel it. It starts to build. You get this little, those little doses of adrenaline and you're kind of on high alert, right? And we get up to the actual graveyard and there's all the tombstones around, and I don't remember what we did, but we walked around and talked for a little while, probably talking about how spooky it was that there were, you know, dead bodies around and it was night and scary or whatever. And then we're sort of chatting and we'd worked ourselves up to a level of fearfulness that all of a sudden something in these tall grasses right over here moved. It's probably a field mouse. But at that point, we were so on alert that we both like startled and bolted down, running down between back through these rows and back towards the iron gate. And I mean, I could have at that moment had no problem imagining something reaching out and grabbing me or coming up from behind. And we rushed back, we sprinted back, we hopped in the truck, fired it up, and go down the road. And then this wave of relief and laughter, and we knew we had done it to ourselves, but just kind of a sense of joy. There's something, and I suppose the right kind of horror movie has something like this for people, where it's like, you work yourself up to this state of fear. You're not really in any danger, probably. But you feel, you get all the excitement and thrill of it, maybe like a roller coaster, without actually being exposed to the actual danger firsthand. And then, and especially maybe if you do it together, there's something sort of cathartic. I mean, who watches a horror movie by themselves, right? You do it with others to have this sort of cathartic relief and this moment of shared experience together, or something like that, I suppose. I got to wondering about fear in the sense that it's something that you would want and desire and pursue. Something where you would want to say to yourself to be afraid, to be very afraid. And what would the positive side of fear be? It's not hard to imagine that in certain contexts, fear is a really important, even an essential human response to actual danger, right? It heightens the alert system. You are ready for whatever it takes in the moment, fight or flight, to try to survive. But there is a sense, in the biblical sense, that calls us to a fear that's a little different than simply being afraid. It's the fear of the Lord. And so we have to figure out a little bit the fear of the Lord in this positive sense, the sense that Proverbs and the Bible generally calls us to cultivate this kind of fear. And what does that mean? Proverbs as a book is presented as the gathering together. It's sort of the sum of wisdom of the king, Solomon, the son of David. He has, as you know, Solomon was renowned for his wisdom, and he seems to have kind of gathered up stories and anecdotes and poems and riddles and parables of wisdom, and then put them all together into this book that we know as the book of Proverbs. And at the outset of the book, right here at the beginning, what we've read, there's kind of an introductory section that gives kind of the quintessential piece of wisdom. Here's a statement of the purpose of this book. It's supposed to, you know, gather together and disseminate wisdom to the old, to the young, to those who don't have any wisdom, they can get some. To those who have some, they can get some more. And then this statement of sort of the basic foundation of the whole thing, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. Bruce Waltke, who's an Old Testament scholar, has a commentary on Proverbs, and he says this. He says, what the alphabet is to reading, notes to reading music, and numerals to mathematics, the fear of the Lord is to attaining the revealed knowledge of this book of Proverbs. Fear, the fear of the Lord in particular, is like a basic building block, like the alphabet, or like musical notes. Waltke also says that it's a compound phrase, fear of the Lord. You can't define the two terms separately and then just add them together. He says it's like the word butterfly. You wouldn't learn much about butterflies if you knew the definition of butter and fly. No, they go together. The fear of the Lord is a compound concept, and he says it has two aspects, both of which I found pretty interesting. He says, first of all, it's a fairly objective thing. It is God's revealed will. The moral life, what a good life is as defined by God and confirmed in human wisdom and experience. So, for example, Psalm 34, the psalmist says, come, my children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Now, maybe you know the phrase like someone says, You could put the fear of God into somebody. That sounds pretty negative, right? But here it's a mode of instruction. And fear of the Lord is, whoever of you loves life and desires to see many good days, keep your tongue from evil and your lips from telling lies. Turn from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. That is what the fear of the Lord is. It is learning this way of life as an individual, as a community, that leads to life. So you can learn the fear of the Lord. It can be taught. Some of you will know Psalm 19, where it gives this list. And in that list, in the second half of Psalm 19, it describes the fear of the Lord, and it puts it in parallel with the Lord's law and statutes and precepts and commands and decrees. It's a body of knowledge that you can learn. So that's one side of fear of the Lord, Waltke says. But he says the other one overlaps and interrelates with it. It's a bit more subjective. It's more of an experience. It's something that involves our emotions and our will, a basic orientation of the heart. So in Deuteronomy 10, "Now, Israel, what does the Lord your God ask of you?" As we read this earlier, "but to fear the Lord your God, to walk in obedience to him, to love him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to observe the Lord's commands and decrees that I'm giving you today for your own good." Again, you learn something about fear of the Lord by looking at the statements that are in parallel to it. It means something like to walk in obedience, to love him, to serve him, to observe his commands. The fear of the Lord is something you can... It's something you can have more or less of. Just as you can love God more or less, or you can serve him more or less, you can subjectively, you can experience more or less of the fear of the Lord. And right there, I suspect we might want to say, well, is fear really the best term here? Is that the best way to translate the word that's there? Wouldn't we better want to use something like respect or awe? And it's a tricky thing for Bible translators, and I think a number of us who preach and teach the Bible at some point want to say, well, fear doesn't really mean fear. It means trust and deep respect, and in a way that would be true, and yet pretty clearly in the Old Testament, the term the fear of the Lord has an overlap with the basic visceral concept of fear. It may mean more than just fear, like fear of the dark, but it doesn't mean less than that. I suspect this is something of the allure of the horror genre for people. Why do they seek it out? Because you seek out this visceral experience. This a horror film is going to give you a story, but a story that's told in a way that is charged with this constant awareness of the danger of the unknown and the thrill of that which is might get you. It's dangerous. I mean, in this sense, there's almost a sense, I think, where if we so tame down our notion of who God is that we experience nothing like fear, then we're sort of missing out, if I can say this respectfully, on some of the fun of believing in God. Some of the allure of it is something like this. There's something wild and uncontrollable and dangerous that when you come into the realm of God, when you come to believe in and know God, you're coming into the presence and experience of something that is so far beyond you, so tremendously holy, so absolutely powerful, so all-knowing, that you can't help but your knees knock a little bit. I mean, we have some work to do, it seems to me, in sorting out bad fear and good fear, that they don't totally bleed into each other. We have to sift out what is this good, righteous, holy kind of fear that we're called to, and what is the kind of fear and fearfulness that we're told to avoid or restrain in ourselves. Consider, as an example, this passage from Exodus. This is when Moses and the people of Israel are at Mount Sinai, and the whole mountain is trembling and quaking with the powerful majesty and holiness of God. And it says, "When the people saw the thunder and lightning and heard the trumpet and saw the mountain and smoke, they trembled with fear." They trembled with fear, and then it says they actually stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself and we'll listen, but don't have God speak to us or we will die." They are afraid for their very lives. And then Moses said to the people, Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. God has come to test you so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning. Isn't that remarkable? And it's not a different phrase. It's the same root word. Don't be afraid. God has come so that you would fear him. Now, that would be a contradiction, except for it seems clear there's two different notions going on here that do overlap, but they're distinct. Don't have this kind of fear, but do have this kind of fear. Don't let your fear keep you away from God's goodness and holiness and justice, but do rightfully fear the prospect that your sinfulness in particular would be an obstacle, that it would keep you away. We experience a part of our fear of God is that God is holy and we are not, that we are sinful and God is sinless, and that we feel that distance and that gap, and we fear the power of God's holiness. Or look at this passage, similarly from the prophet Isaiah. It says, "This is what the Lord says to me with his strong hand upon me, warning me not to follow the way of this people." It says, "Do not call conspiracy everything this people calls a conspiracy." That's a good word for an age of a lot of conspiracy theories. But then it says, "Do not fear what they fear, and do not dread it. The Lord Almighty is the one you are to regard as holy. He is the one you are to fear. He is the one you are to dread." Fear and dread as an essential component of what it is to know God. This comes together beautifully. You'll not be surprised if those who know me well in The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe. The children in that book have heard something about Aslan. He's very powerful. They're a little nervous. And then they learn, when they're with Mr. and Mrs. Beaver, they learn that Aslan is actually a lion. And Susan says, "Well, is he quite safe? I shall feel rather nervous about meeting a lion." And Mrs. Beaver, wisely, says, "If there's anyone who can appear before Aslan without their knees knocking, they're either braver than most or else just silly." And Lucy, Susan's sister, says, "Then he isn't safe?" And Mr. Beaver says, "Who said anything about safe? Of course he isn't safe, but he's good. He's the king, I tell you." We would be just plain silly to think we could stand before the God who created the cosmos, the God of absolute justice and absolute holiness, without our knees knocking. And maybe especially in a world where so many people experience a sense of meaninglessness, a sense of vague purposelessness, maybe that's some of the draw of the horror, to just for a moment feel just viscerally alive, to drive out all those feelings of vague hopelessness and meaninglessness, to at least feel something. I mean, a movie that's a comedy might hit or miss. You may or may not think it's funny. A drama might grab you or not, but a horror film can pretty predictably shock and terrify you. And to want something of that where I just feel deeply alive. One more thing. I want to talk about fear and love. Because in a way, maybe we wonder, as if we're here today as not just Old Testament people speaking of the fear of the Lord, but New Testament believers who know Christ Jesus, then haven't we moved away from this realm and experience of fear to the one of love? And what would we say about that? Well, there's a lot of things you might say. I'll just take one New Testament passage here. It says, Paul writes, "Therefore, my dear friends, as you have always obeyed, not only in my presence, but now much more in my absence, continue to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you to will and to act in order to fulfill his good purpose." His purpose in you is good, but you should work at it with a degree of fear and trembling, because you're, well, the very shape and integrity of your soul is at stake when you work out your salvation. Work it out with a degree of fear and trembling. When we come to the New Testament and we come to the very person of Jesus, what we find is that fear, I would say, finds its fulfillment in love. Jesus inspired all kinds of reaction from the people who encountered him. But let's not miss the fact that, well, often the powerful religious and political leaders feared him a bit, feared his popularity, feared his appeal with the crowds. When he encountered demon-possessed persons, demons would cry out, seemingly in terrified fear of Jesus. And common, ordinary people, on a number of occasions when they were in Jesus' presence, though he was a human like them, they bowed down in awe and worship before him. They experienced something of the fear of the Lord in the presence now of this person, Jesus. Some of you will know well the quote from the character on The Office, Michael Scott, the boss. He says, "Would I rather be feared or loved?" Easy, both. I want people to be afraid of how much they love me. It's a great, great line. And I think Jesus' word to us would be a bit different, but it would be something like, "Do I want you to fear me or love me?" Well, both. I want you to experience the fear of the Lord. I want you to be afraid in that sense of how much I love you, of the lengths to which I would go and have gone to reconcile you to this holy and tremendous and powerful God. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. It's the beginning. Love is the end. Love is the goal and purpose, to begin to lay the foundations with a proper, due, respectful fear of the Lord and his goodness and all that he calls us to be rightfully afraid that as sinful people we might miss out on the glory and goodness of God, and then to be in a fearful wonder at the lengths to which God has gone in Christ Jesus to redeem us, to deliver us, and to bring us to himself. Fear, the fear of the Lord, is the beginning of knowledge and wisdom. And its end is love, a love that includes and fulfills the fear and goes beyond it. In Christ Jesus, we get this amazing combination of experiences throughout our lives of deep and holy longing and a joyful fear and the awe of being so completely loved in a way far beyond our control, in a way that is always good but is never safe. Always good, but never safe. He's the King, I tell you. And let's go to him in prayer. Lord and King Jesus Christ, we marvel at you as the one under whom God has placed all things, a human like us in every respect except for sin. And because you are the one without sin, you've been able to offer your life as a sacrifice for us. Poured out. It is astonishing to think that one who knows us so deeply could still love us so completely. It's astonishing to us to think that you want to transform us into being more and more like you. It's a fearful prospect, one in which we're not in control, one that doesn't feel particularly safe to us. And yet, by your Spirit in us, we trust that you are good. And so we worship you, praising you for your love, acknowledging you as our King, and praying all this in your holy name. And all God's people said, Amen. We're going to sing in response this hymn, this classic hymn, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. It speaks of love, but it also speaks of a trembling awe and awareness. I invite you to rise as able as we sing together.
Love divine, all
Just one word of announcement. If you are here and you'd like to have a chance to have someone to speak with and pray with, we'll have an elder who's available at the prayer room there to your right as you exit, your left currently. Likewise, if you're worshiping with us via the live stream, if there's ways we can be in contact with you or in prayer for you, please leave a comment or reach out to us. There's contact info noted there. But then, people of God, go in the blessing of God. May the Lord and King Jesus Christ bless you and keep you. Make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you now and forevermore his abiding peace. Amen and amen.
Love and serve the Lord.